Such an honor to work with you, such an honor to be found in this house. Praise the Lord. Are you a visitor visiting with us for the first time in the first service? You have never been here before. Is this your first time to be here? If you lifted your hand, I would see it. And then we'll appreciate you, make you feel welcome in this service. Are you here? Amen. Tell your neighbor again. Oh, there is a visitor over there. Oh, just come and appreciate. Just stand up so that we can see you wherever you are. Just arise. Thank you very much. Come and appreciate our demo. 1, 2, 3. Jesus loves you and me, all of us. We appreciate you. Thank you for making a decision to come and fellowship with us. You can make that place your place. If it is too far, you can shift to wherever you want. Oh, praise the Lord. Come and appreciate her again as she sits. Thank you very much. God bless you. Are you also here for the first time, though you're a member of this church, but this is not your service? You come for the second or the third service. Are you here? We can appreciate you too. Are you here? Yeah. From celebration? Yes. Come on, appreciate our sister. All the way from the other services to be here. Amen. That's a privilege, is it not? I hope you also visit other services so that you can benefit. We are looking at the life of Paul and the ministry of Paul, and I'll be reading the book of Romans. If you can get there to the book of Romans, chapter 16. Paul, an apostle of Jesus, the Bible says he's a bond servant. He likes calling himself a bond servant or a slave of the Lord. A slave, you know, the Christian life is a mystery. You'd think that we liberation of freedom is just being set free to do what you want, but actually the Christian life is being brought from one slavery to another. That you are under the slavery of Satan, now you are a slave of Christ. That you are not just set free to do whatever you like, but you are set free to be led of the Spirit. So you are a slave. Yeah. You are a slave of Christ. You are taken to another kingdom. So you live under the guidance of the Spirit. So you are a slave. You are a child of God. It is not freedom to do anything. I've realized even financial freedom is not to have all the money to buy everything you want. It is to have all the money, yet not to choose not to buy. That is freedom, isn't it? So Christian life is about being a servant and a slave. And we are looking at the life of one of the greatest apostles that was so successful, though he calls himself the least of them all. But the grace of God helped him. In 1 Corinthians 15:10, we are told, I am what I am by the grace of God. For the grace of God that was given to me was not in vain. For I labored above them all, yet not I, but the grace of God that was upon me. He continues to say that though he came after Christ, but by the grace of God he was made to be the greatest apostle, because the great mysteries, revelation and wisdom was revealed to him, being able to communicate to the church. So Paul did great things that people had never done. He moved in the continent of Asia and preached the gospel in 2.5 years. He had preached across all the nations in Asia. And because he was a committed guy, looking at the end of his, very few people are given the privilege to know the end of their journey. And Paul, before he reaches the end of the journey, says, I have run a good race. I have fought a good fight. I have finished the course. Now kept before me is a prize, a crown of righteousness, isn't it? Very few people are given that privilege to know that their end is near. And he was not somebody who was fearful about going or death. Because, he was joking around it, saying, for me to live is Christ, to die is gain. See, if I'm absent in this body, I am with Christ. But if I'm present, I'm here to help you. So I am here for your benefit. But if I'm going, it's for my benefit, isn't it? Yeah. So either way, he was not losing. Yeah. Paul was a confident guy, walked with God, received great revelation. And my question is, what made the life of Paul very successful? Besides the revelation and the wisdom that Paul received, what made his life separated and very successful in his ministry and work? His Christian work was very successful because he surmounted greatest challenges. If you see the way God used Paul, you'd think that he used to live the most comfortable of life, like the preaching we have today. But Paul went through a lot of adversity, yet he was the most anointed of the Lord, isn't it? He said, through persecution, through shipwreck, I was left for the dead. You see, I fought wild animals and I went through hunger and thirst. I've known how to go without food. I've known how to go without supplies or resources. But the grace of God was sufficient for him, because he knew there was a crown that was bigger than himself that was kept for him. The Bible talks about Paul writing to the Philippian church. He said, for the glory that was set before him, that is Christ, he endured the cross, or the pain that was at the present moment, because Christ understood that there was greater glory ahead of him, more than the temporary suffering he was passing through. But Paul had seen this revelation. That is why he was going through what he was going through. And in Romans chapter 16, we want to see one of the secrets of Paul's success in ministry. And it's a whole chapter, so we are going to read, and it's good to read scripture, especially long passages, because, of course, some of us don't read on their own, so we can help them in church. All right? So open your Bibles. We're going to have a long reading in Romans chapter 16. Are you there? Paul is writing to the Roman church. Page 1001. It says, I commend to you Phoebe, our sister, who is a servant of the church in Cilicia, a servant of the church. And we'll just be going through to find out the people that have surrounded Paul. You know, he's giving a testimony of the kind of people that have surrounded Paul. And I think it's very important for us to be surrounded with such people, isn't it? If we are able to make an impact in the world, it's good for us to be surrounded with such people. But most importantly, it is good for us to be such people. Because most of the time we are looking for such people around us, but we are not asking ourselves, are we such people? Because you are looking for faithful people, but are you a faithful person? Because the greatest thing, as Bishop says, is not to get the right partner, is to be the right partner. If you're the right partner, then people who surround you are going to be great people. So the first category of people are Phoebe, who is a servant of the church. That's the first kind of people that surrounded Paul, a servant of the church. And how many people today are servants of the church? How many people are not serving the church out of convenience or when things are going right, but they are servants? They have given their lives to the service of the church. They have given their lives to the service of God's people. Not about what they are going to receive in return, but they give as a service to the Lord. It's a selfless act. Beyond recognition, beyond appreciation, beyond anything that anybody will ever say, but they have given themselves out to serve the church. And church is not just a denomination. Church is the beloved, the saints, the called out of God. Any Christian that is all over the world, you've given yourself to his service. You are a servant of the church. So the first category of people that surrounded Paul are servants of the church. And you can ask your neighbor, are you a servant of the church? Yeah, how are you serving the church? Because most of us are looking to be served. I was not served properly. The message was not powerful. The praise and worship was not powerful. Have you ever asked yourself, were you powerful in the service of the people? Because when you're lighting fire, it is not the fire that was lit that keeps the fire. It is the firewood that is dry. So if you receive dry firewood in the church, when bishops light the fire in this church, there's going to be great fire. The problem comes when the fire is wet. If all of us came on Sunday morning and we are wet, no matter what kind of fire is lit in this place, it's going to die down, isn't it? Are you a servant of the church? And how are you serving the church? I mean, if you took a stock of last week in the last 7 days, how have you served the church? How have you texted somebody, prayed with somebody, fasted, not because you had a problem, but for the sake of somebody else? Because it is easy to fast or to supplicate or to petition God when you have a problem. And that is human nature, to remember God when there is a problem. But have you gone out of your way to supplicate on behalf of somebody else? To say, this week I'm not going to have food or everything I usually have, but I'm going to kneel down, supplicate, deny myself for the sake of somebody else. A servant of the church. Can you say amen? Amen. That was Phoebe, a servant of the church, that you may receive her in the Lord in a manner worthy of the saints, and a sister in the whatever business she has need for you, for indeed she has been a helper of many and of myself also. See, Paul was talking about Phoebe and talking to the Roman church. He was saying, when she comes to you, receive them in the manner worthy of the saints. Meaning, there is a way saints receive people. There is a way saints receive people. There must be a distinction between how the pagans receive people and how a saint receives people. I mean, if they come to your workplace, other than the long testimony you have, can they distinguish, this is a Christian? This behaves like a Christ. Remembering that Christians, from the genesis of the word Christian, is not that the Christians call themselves Christians. They were called Christians because their behavior was like Christ. Amen? Today we have testimonies, but not without with action. In fact, I was reading a book recently about Yogi Cho. He was saying that we would not even need to do harvest or evangelism events if you live like Christ. Because if you live like Christ in your estate, people will be wondering, what manner of man is this? Now, when you tell them, please, people, members of my church will be coming on Tuesday. They want to talk to you. They'll be more than happy, isn't it? The problem is, you have lived in such a way that people around you don't want to associate with you in any way. In fact, when they hear people from your church are coming, they think they are like you. And somebody says, so many people are non-Christians, either because they have met a Christian or they have not met a Christian. Either they have not met a Christian, so they do not know the gospel. Or they have met a Christian and they do not like what they saw. Okay? So, are you receiving people in the manner worthy of the saints? There is a way that saints receive people. There is also a way, you know, in families. How do you receive your family members, for instance? If you hear it is your spouse that is knocking at the door, do you even go to find out who is knocking? I'm a medjingia, can you sort? Yeah, you'll know each other by dying. Or do you receive them in the manner worthy of the gospel, isn't it? Worthy of the saints. He says, and a sister in whatever business she has need of you. Meaning, the second kind of people are helpers. Helpers. Helpers are people who are ready to assist. Do you need something? Can I assist something? And that is usually, when we say we are waiting on God, you know, the traditional classic sense of the word waiter was somebody who was able just to stand by the side of the table to find out what the customer needed. They were not in a hurry, just standing there to keep on asking the customer, can I help you? Do you need anything? Can I assist you? Are you okay, sir? That is a waiter. Well, forget about the busy schedules that our waiters have in this country, depending on which hotel you go. You know, there are hotels where waiters are so busy, and there are other hotels where waiters scream. You say, ugali surwa. Then you hear, ugali surwa. Those are not waiters. But waiters are people who are just waiting to serve you. When was the last time you helped somebody? I mean, went up to wait just to ask, can I assist you? You walked out of this place and found a young man out there, says, by the way, how are you? Are you employed? Can I assist? Isn't it? can I be of service to you? But most of the time we're asking ourselves, people are not helping us. Yesterday we were traveling with Jen and we were wondering, I mean, have you noticed the cancer in our society today? About people nowadays cannot help for free. We have lost the humanness, isn't it? You'd wonder that maybe if you found a woman by the side of the road and her car is broken down, people would come and say, how can I help? Are you safe? But most of the times, even when you're stuck in mud, they see a business opportunity. They're not coming out to help. And by the way, before you notice, they'll come out so, well, madam, how can we assist? And then you think it's for free. By the time you finish, they say, hey. And you'll say, you give him 100 shillings, says, no, this is not enough. What can 100 shillings buy? It's like you had a contract, which you didn't know about. But this has permeated the whole structure of society, that people are not doing anything for nothing. They must be paid for anything. And you're asking, what is in need for me? And that has, if you're not careful, that can also go to your Christian life, that you only serve God to be paid. You're asking, God, I'll do this so that you bless me. What about giving yourself selflessly, saying like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, even if he does not save us? We know this God. Job loved God so much that he says, would we only expect good things from him and not bad? Imagine loving God until you expect even bad things. That is love, isn't it? But most of us expect only good things. So Phoebe was a helper. A helper. He says, assist them in any manner of business they would need of you, for indeed she has been a helper of many and myself also. And people in the church stand up and say, that woman, she's a great helper. That man is a great helper. Greet Priscilla and Aquila, my fellow workers in Christ Jesus. The next category of people are fellow workers. It is hard to get workers. The Bible truth of laborers are few is still true in church today. Mm-hmm. That the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. The Pareto principle is already also happening in church, that you have 80% consumers, but 20% doing the job. In every organization you go, you have the 20% of who are workers, 80% are asking, what is our allocation? Because people want to be served, but they're not asking, how do I serve? Just imagine in a church like almost here, like almost 3,000 people, if everybody did something. Isn't it? If everybody did something, we'd have a wonderful and easy life, isn't it? A few people will not be overburdened because everybody will be doing something. These are fellow workers. Number four, who risk their own necks for my life, to whom not only I give thanks, but also all the churches of the Gentiles. We have the next kind of people who are risk takers. These are risk takers. People who take risk on behalf of others. Risk takers. Do you know there are people who do not go beyond their comfort to help anybody or to do anything else? They are comfortable. I must sleep for 10 hours. Don't disturb my sleep. You know, my family and my children, yeah? That's what I was called to do. They do not go beyond anything that is going to to give them discomfort, because they are not risk. Ask your neighbor, are you a risk taker? On behalf of others. This took risk. Likewise, greet the church that is in their house, greet my beloved Apennetus, who is the first fruits of Achaia to Christ. Greet Mary, who labored much for us. Six is laborers. Laborers are ox. People who are driven, self-driven people. They do not need to be told anything. They are workers. Have you seen workers in your life? People who labor. People who are out there. And you wonder what kind of energy that this guy has. They are laborers. Greet Abanas, our fellow worker in Christ, and teachers, my beloved. Greet Apelles, approved in Christ. Number 10, That is verse 10. It says, greet Apelles, approved in Christ. Greet those who are of the household of Aristobulus. These people are tested, approved. You have people around you who are approved. I mean, these are kind of people that lift your faith, isn't it? You know, approved people are people who have passed through adversity in life, but they are still standing. There are people who have gone through situations in life, but you see them stand. And most of the time, they don't even tell you about it. Yeah? Because sometimes, you know, it takes time to know people, isn't it? And you might be seeing somebody from outside, but you don't know their story. Because you see them well-dressed, you know, with the nice makeup, but you don't know their journey. Because sometimes they have passed through things that have killed others. But they have stood, isn't it? There are people who are proved. There are people who are tested. And because of their testing and their approval, they have one or two things they can share with you about where they have gone through. You know, it is very easy to turn and say, talking to the widows, be strong, love the Lord, because you have your husband. And by the end of the day, you go back and he does a massage for you. But remember, Christ does not do massage for people, isn't it? But you need to ask him your story. How was it? Some things you may not know. Don't be easy to say, I know, I understand. No, you don't understand. If you haven't gone through it, you cannot understand it. So there are people around you who are tested, and it's good to be around them. To ask themselves, how was your journey? Because today you might be seeing success, but you don't know the journey. You know, look at Bishop and say, Tuareg, I want to drive this. I want to have this kind of a church. Eh? If you're given the life story, you say, I don't want to be a pastor. Because now you have the story, isn't it? But if you look from the surface, because you look at people coming to church, holding hands, you say, I want to be like this couple. Oh, you don't want. Because what they have passed through, you may not want to pass through. Yeah? Say, these people with a nice job, with a Mercedes Benz, you don't know this guy stayed like 10 years without a job. Yeah? These people did not have anything to eat, isn't it? Because you don't know that story. You say, God, bless me like this guy. Don't pray those kind of prayers. Because if they took you through their journey, you will be dead. But God loves you so much, isn't it? You know, every time that you go to our teacher and says, I think I've overqualified for this class, I want to go to the next class. What does the teacher do? He gives you a test, isn't it? He says, I think I am more than class one, I want to go to class two. Does he just say, okay, the following day go to class two? No, he gives you a test, isn't it? So if you take that analogy and come to God in church and say, God, take me to the next level. Oh God, expand my boundaries. What are you telling God? Good, I want to see the next glory. He says, fine, that's a good prayer. So you go in the morning at work and you find your boss has changed. Totally. Sending you, now you're transferred to Garissa. Oh God, why me? No, it's an answer to your prayer, isn't it? God is testing. Are you ready for the next level? Say, God, I am. Why me? Then you go back for a week, you are recalled. He says, your failed exam, the same position. That's how the children of Israel were going to, through the same mountain, over and over. They go through once, they tell God, God, were there not graves in Egypt? Go back again. God, you want us to die in the wilderness. But immediately you say, God, I'm here. Do whatever you like with your servant. The next level. Because you are accepting what God is doing in your life. Hallelujah. Now, those are tested. And the people who are tested are powerful people. People who are tested are powerful people. Because people who are tested, their words are measured. They have seen, that's why when you go to a show and tell you your story, like you are a couple, you have disagreed on something, and you're telling, my husband is this, my husband. She will really take time to talk. Because she wants to hear also the other side. But if you have not, you are not advanced in age. By the way, when you listen to one side of the couple, you will want to kill the other one. True or true? You wonder what kind of monster do you live with? Terrible. Because she's telling you her side, isn't it? And then after some time you meet the husband. Now he tells you his sight. You say, my goodness. That woman is wicked. That woman is a devil. Because there are always two sides, isn't it? In fact, there are three sides. The one party side, the other party side, and the true side. That's why you go to church and you say, my wife is like this. She's just quiet. You ask him, can't you say something? Because she's tested. She has known in life, you also have a contribution. For every conflict, you have a contribution. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Now, the question is not, do I have those kind of friends? The question is, are you such kind of a friend? Now, as you think about those kind of people, these are the kind of people to avoid. Verse 17. Now I urge you, brethren, not those who cause divisions and offenses. There are people who cause divisions and offenses. The people who do not gather together, they scatter. They're always thinking about the wrong thing that is happening. They are not celebrating the good things. They tell you, do you know so and so? Oh, this is your friend. By the way, did you know? We went to school together with this guy. You don't know him. Those are people called divisions and offenses. They're always looking for people to separate. They're always scattering unity. The people who look for offenses and divisions, keep off from them. Attract people around you who are looking for unity. Whatever disagreement is, look for people who are saying, there's a solution. We can find a solution, right? Contrary to the doctrine which we learned and avoid them. For those who are such do not serve the Lord Jesus Christ, but their own belly. Concerned only of their belly. What is in it for me? The people who move close to you, by the way, about what they got gain, isn't it? How much? This is a CEO of a company. So, let's have fellowship, brother. It's not that they love you, no. Somebody said, I think it was Francis who was sharing, that they went to a funeral somewhere and people, this strong man, I think it was who, Chotara or someone, people went there just, the people were so many in a funeral. And people were wondering, this guy was loved. No, the people who come to a funeral just to confirm, that guy's dead. Is that guy truly dead? So you might be thinking, oh, people this love these people. No, they don't love. And there are people who coalesce around you just because of what you have. They did that for Jesus. Jesus looked at them and said, no, if you don't love me, you've come for bread. I know. You've come for bread. How do you know that? Lose your position or your privileges. You find you have very few friends. Because when you're having a lot of money and you're in this job, there were so many fellowships in your house, you're wondering. People love fellowship, my goodness. But now after you lost it, do you still have fellowship? No, because they came for something, isn't it? But there are genuine people who surround you because of the fellowship of the Lord. Now there, and by smooth words, there are people who are called smooth talkers. They are smooth talkers. And I've realized as I continue to interact in church it's very hard to say the truth. Because just to say somebody, this is wrong, correct this. This one, grow up. It's not easy. Because we are not from that culture. We are, you know, it is well. You are a blessing. But somebody will look at you and say, my sister, my grandmother used to say like this. Well, she was to the extreme anyway. She used to sit at the marketplace and call a lady, anybody, randomly. Please come. Says, my girl, where do you stay? Says, this is where I stay. Why? Do you stay with anyone? Says, yes, I stay with people. Okay. All those people will not tell you that you are dressed pathetically. But all those... all those people, imagine you live in a house where you are five people. They can't tell you that you look terrible. So, we have what we call the love mirrors. The people who just appreciate good things in you, isn't it? But do you know, to make the next step in your life, you also need the honest mirrors. The people will look you in the face and say, this one you are doing wrong. This direction you've taken is not a good one. I wish as a Christian you find a few people around there. Because even churches today, people are choosing churches according to people who will pamper them. But it is hard, by the way, to stay under one roof for a long time, where people know you, where people can correct you, a pastor who understands your life. You know, most of us want to go to a pastor who is a stranger, who does not know you, but somebody who has seen your life, who has walked with you. That's a powerful person, isn't it? So find the people around you, people who are honest enough, and tell you, by the way. Okay. Next time, by the way, don't give jokes. Because that's not your head. Because you are laughing only yourself. People are not laughing. Because you may think, that is funny. I've said a joke. My goodness. And I've noticed that husbands who are very, very humorous, their wives usually don't laugh. But have you noticed? Just look keenly. You know, I look at, well, there is this bishop called Bishop Harrison Nana. Do you know Bishop Harrison Nana? No, this guy jokes throughout. Look at the wife. The wife is just like this. Maybe at home you are wondering, what were you saying exactly? So, find honest mirrors. And flattering speech deceives the hearts of the simple, isn't it? There are people who are smooth talkers and flatterers. Oh, I have missed you. I have missed you. That guy never thought about you, ever. And you know, you have that in church. Brother, you are a blessing. I have missed you. If you missed, can't you call? I've been away for 3 months, you've never called, you've never texted. Exactly how do you miss people? So if you've not missed anybody, just say you never missed them. Right? Welcome, Pastor Lillian. I did miss you, but it's good to have you. Let's arise. Beautiful. Hallelujah. And the prayer today is not, God, bring those kind of people around me. The prayer today is, God, make me that person. Transform me by the renewal of my hand, my heart and my mind. To the people that surround me, let me be a laborer. Let me be a risk taker on their behalf. Let me be a servant of the church. Let me not be a flatterer or a smooth talker. Let me not cause divisions or offense among the people I relate with. Let me be a contributor, a helper. Make me that kind of a person. Come on, lift up your hands and just worship him. Make a prayer. Make a passionate prayer. Just the way you pray for money and houses, the way you are passionate. Make that prayer this morning. God, make me that kind of a person. Today, in the name of Jesus, there will be a support, a helper. To those people who look upon me, those people who have enlisted my support, that I may be a pillar to those people around me in the name of Jesus. I may be a faithful and a true friend in the mighty name of the Lord. Rasokata shentararas shirarabasa. It can only be done by your presence and by your spirit, oh God. Oh, hallelujah, 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 Jesus. Make me the kind of a person, oh God, in the name of Jesus, out of my frailty, out of my weaknesses, out of my background, oh God. My God, out of my shortcomings, in the name of Jesus, help me to be that kind of a person, that I shall be a blessing to people in the name of the Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah, Hallelujah. Let me make that prayer for you. Are you here and you need that kind of a prayer? Hallelujah, hallelujah. Shararababosa, antarababosa. How many people are telling God, God, make me that kind of a person. I want to make a prayer with you. As I also pray for that kind of prayer, in the name of Jesus. Lord Jesus, we thank you for the preaching of your word. As the dew falleth upon the face of the earth and produces abundance, so is a word from your mouth, it shall never return to you void, O God. I pray that your work shall form in us the kind of a person that you like us to be in the name of Jesus. Those around us shall see a helpmate, O God, shall see a helper, shall see a fellow worker, a laborer in the name of Jesus. It shall not be found of me and of us, O God, be divisive people, to be offenders, O God. We shall not be smooth sayers, O God, and flatterers, Jehovah. We shall be honest mirrors and a true faithful friend to those that are around us in the name of the Lord. Receive every praise and glory, Almighty God, in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Hallelujah.